So yeah, formally to all our participants today, a warm welcome to the last webinar of the Smart Protein Innovation Challenge. This is the 12th webinar, and this is focused mainly on feedstock optimization needs for fermentation. I am Akshay Bhatt, the Science and Technology Specialist with GFI India, and we'll be hosting this session today. We also have Nicole Rook, our Innovation Specialist, GFI India, as co-host for support. So general rules for engagement, as usual, you as a participant can use the Q&A button for questions to the speaker, and the speaker today is me. So also feel free to use the chat button to share any thoughts or any links which can help other participants as well, but please not use it for private conversations. And also after the webinar, we'll have a Q&A session where all your questions will be answered, hopefully. And if I'm not able to answer because I'm not a big expert in this field, but I'll be giving a very, very broad overview as to what would be some of the feedstock optimization solutions for across fermentation, basically. But after the webinar, you'll have this option to raise your hand and ask a question directly. I can unmute you and we can go through your question and let's see if it's possible for me to answer some of them. And hopefully we'll also have one more fermentation expert. Her name is Michal. Michal from GFI Israel. Unfortunately, she couldn't actually conduct this webinar because of time constraints, and that's the reason why I've taken on this. But she'll be available, hopefully, at the end of this session to answer any questions which you guys will have. Let me check if it's here, if she's here. Yeah, she's here. So hi, Michal. Okay, so I'll go ahead with my presentation, and perhaps Michal can join later for the Q&A session to answer any questions you all will have for today. So as I said before, today I'll be covering various feedstocks and optimization criteria, strategies across fermentation areas, mainly traditional fermentation, biomass, as well as precision fermentation. I'll give a very bird's eye view kind of the current state of this particular area of the value chain and what are some of the considerations for optimizing media for strain match, yield, as well as efficiency. So before we jump into the session, like always, the India Smart Protein Innovation Challenge would or could not have been possible without the generous support of our sponsors. Our title sponsor, Capri Global, our key sponsors, NICE and Alchem Foundation, organizing partner CII Co, supporting partners, BioRack, NIFT, and CCAMP, AICCC, and the IIT Madras Bioincubator, Cyan Label, our ecosystem enabling partners, Blue Horizon, DSG, Fixi, Brink, Ankur Capital, Axelor Labs, ProVich, Omnivore, Agni, Ahimsa Ventures, Brigadier Ventures, and Hadoop. So this is what all the RFPs look like. I think you guys have gone through these, the people who are in track one, and probably the webinar today feeds into probably all of these three RFPs in one or the other ways. And also in terms of track two, I think the kind of optimization media webinar which we are hosting today will be applicable to certain areas of plant-based as well as cultivated meat, especially where teams are looking forward. I know a couple of teams are looking into that area in terms of creating high-value ingredients to fermentation, which could plug into specific value chain areas of cultivated meat, for example, culture media optimization. So we'll just quickly go through what the generalities of microbial fermentation. It's basically the cultivation of microorganisms, which typically include single-cell organisms. We are specifically talking about certain kinds of bacteria, yeast, filamentous fungi, and algae, and may also include organisms that associate into multicellular structures, such as fungal mycelia. So a brief, quick history. Fermentation goes way back into long times in history. There have been many evidences of using fermentation to produce food, and you all know lots of examples of it. For example, the instance of beer, cheese, curd, and it was also used as a method for food preservation, where or when, you know, refrigeration was not available. So the use of fermentation, particularly beverages, has existed since Neolithic ages probably. This has been found dated back into 7000 BC in China, 5000 BC in India, and so on and so forth in several multiple countries. The turning point came when Louis Pasteur, during the 1850s and 1860s, showed fermentation is initiated by living organisms in a series of investigations, and also showed lactic acid fermentation is caused by living organisms. And then on, a century after that, advances in microbiology and fermentation technology have continued steadily up until the present, and strain selection and hybridization developed as well, affecting most modern food fermentation. So fermentation now spans industrial chemistry, biomaterials, therapeutics, medicine, fuels, advanced food ingredients, and now alternative proteins. And the suite of tools developed through fermentation's evolution is now poised to revolutionize the food sector by accelerating the rise of smart proteins. So fermentation is basically the metabolic process of microorganisms performing the absence of oxygen to generate energy. The glucose is transformed to pyruvate, which then is used in the mitochondria to generate ADP. And this is true when oxygen is present. However, when no oxygen is present, the pyruvate is used to recycle the NAD in order for the microorganisms to continue consuming the glucose. So the byproducts of the cycle are lactic acid and alcohol, I think, which everybody knows, probably all the participants in this webinar. So basically, now what we are seeing is that fermentation has expanded, like I said before, into several other areas. If you look at food and feed specifically, the applications of fermentation in food supplements, for example, citric acid, vitamin C, beverages, that vitamin C is again used, citric acid is again used. And also in terms of producing saccharides, amino acids, as well as biomass such as yeast and algae. Pharma has been always a big industry for fermentation in terms of creating antibiotics, diagnostics, and we'll discuss some of the applications of feedstock optimization and how we can draw in some insights and some kind of knowledge from the pharma sector currently existing in terms of optimizing media, specifically for precision fermentation. And also it moves into biofuels and chemicals, which is also a very, very large industry in terms of production of biomethanol, bioethanol, isobutanol, and biopolymers as well off lately. So this is the application or snapshot of how genomic analysis as well as synthetic biology is actually transforming the sector very, very rapidly across the world. And you see that how traditional fermentation and precision as well as biomass fermentation are somewhat interrelated, and there are a lot of interapplications between all these three all these three segments of, let's say, fermentation. For example, synthetic biology in terms of traditional fermentation is used to create new culture substrate combinations, improve yields, for example, or better control fermentation conditions. And in terms of precision fermentation, obviously synthetic biology plays a very, very critical role in terms of producing customized products. Most of you already know about several precision fermentation companies cropping up abroad in developed countries and coming up in India as well slowly. Basically in terms of novel food ingredients, or let's say increasing the production efficiency or higher yields, etc. So also in terms of biomass fermentation, in terms of usage of non-food substrates, which basically plugs into scaffolding. And also, I think this is from a paper, so it says alternative protein production, which is true for precision as well as traditional fermentation as well. So the opportunities of fermentation, everybody knows now that it's feedstock optimization, strain development, fermentation bioprocess design, and also in terms of what kind of bulky and special final products your company or your team is ideating on specifically. So today's focus, as you all know, is on feedstock optimization, which is any source of biomass which can serve as a feedstock for fermentation-based protein production. And we can see, we'll see how feedstock optimization, let's say, interacts with strain development, and also perhaps to a great extent in terms of fermentation bioprocess design as well. So this is basically the new feed industry. It's plants, algae, bacteria, fungi, or even let's say side stream biomass, which caters to these broad segments, that is high molecular weight proteins, which is probably has high utility for plant-based meat and eggs and dairy products, right? Which basically forms the bulk of the let's say product, or maybe a large portion of amount or proportion of this plant-based meat, eggs and dairy products. Whereas on the other hand, we have amino acids and small peptides, which has extremely high utility in terms of cultivated meat production. You can think about in terms of, let's say, cost reduction when you have fermented amino acids or small peptides supplementing the amino acids, which are currently being used in terms of, culturing of cells. I think this has got great potential in terms of, let's say, there is techniques or methodologies or technologies which are built around creating or producing amino acids at a fraction of the cost, which currently it is produced at. So at the same time, we have simple sugars as well as longer polysaccharides, which has high utility in terms of microbial fermentation itself, in terms of, let's say, production of ingredients, enzymes, even growth factors and fungal protein. And some of them could also have applications on scaffolding for cultivated meat. So fermentation as a technology has a slightly different kind of supply chain, but many opportunities do lie, mainly in terms of sourcing, let's say, cheap feedstocks, which can either be biomass waste streams, such as agricultural residues, or co-locating fermentation facilities near resources of, let's say, for example, sugar feedstocks as wet milling facilities of corn or something, finding consistent supply, quality and low cost feedstocks or raw materials, and also keep a pulse of the rapidly changing landscape of the industry, anticipate demand and be able to quickly adapt and increase production in response to this demand. So this is basically very, very important in terms of, to mitigate upstream supply chain challenges when a company moves forward from, let's say, startup to, let's say, a little more mature kind of a company. So the other bottleneck is designing microbial strains that can withstand or thrive in feedstock diversity, right? So that's how I was telling previously about how the interplay between feedstock optimization as well as strain development happens. For example, if you are able to develop a strain which can actually be much more versatile and withstand or thrive in feedstock, variety of feedstocks, basically, then you have a game changer with you, right? So it's all about, which of these areas you want to optimize in terms of the best kind of or best set of end results which you want at the end of the day. and also optimizing microbial host strains for bioprocessing plant crops, creating, for example, wholesale protein biomass to be used in the final end product, such as the corn mycoprotein, which probably everybody knows about it by now. So for example, also something which is everybody knows about it, kind of the impossible soy legume globin recombinant protein, which adds this bloody kind of a flavor to their product. So this is basically through getting something out of precision fermentation in terms of creating and isolating the soy legume globin. So improving fermentation tanks, also known as bioreactors, where fermentation takes place, for example, like the enrichment of used feedstocks, could be something which can actually play an important role in terms of yield and efficiency and in terms of, let's say, a circular economy kind of model. So better bioprocess designs and services such as sensors and tools for assessing feedstock inputs could also be very critical, as well as monitoring and controlling conditions within these fermentation tanks. So I think what we are focusing today is probably on the first two areas in terms of sourcing, as well as not really designing microbial strains, but see how we can actually optimize this feedstock. So yeah, these are some of the various feedstock which I just wanted to highlight here. So the first kind of feedstock is basically sugar and starch, which is the most widely used kind of a feedstock for biosynthetic polymers as of now. where starch is used for 80% of the bioplastics today. But many of these feedstocks can be adopted to produce fermented foods, right? So the glucose and sugars are taken directly from, let's say, sugar-based crops. And in case of sugar, starch-based crops, glucose and sugars are broken down from plants. Fermented sugars can also be processed further into, let's say, high-value ingredients or low-value, high-volume ingredients. Whereas the same fermented sugars can also be utilized by microbes, which could produce molecules for, let's say, biomass for fermentation. So basically, the advantages of this feedstock is established supply chains, flexibility of growing regions, and ease of processing as well. And you see that some of these sugar and starch, let's say, raw materials are widely present across various geographic areas such as US, China, Brazil, Thailand, etc. So again, the cost is depends on the starch, sugar, wherever the region of harvest, for example. And sustainability, I've just put these points here to just note that the land use has not been still in terms of validated to be actually confirmed, and the kind of GMO implication is mixed, right? So it's not like you have one specific, you could have a GMO involved, you could not have a GMO involved. It's all up to what you really want to do with your feedstock. Or your feedstock, which is plugging into producing your target of interest or your fermented product. So the next kind is basically lipids or oil. These feedstocks are usually used specifically in textiles within the polyamide area. So despite the regional as well as seasonal variation, some of these oil crops is harvested with relatively uniformly, and also makes it a attractive feedstock choice. But basically, for example, there was a study done by a couple of scientists where they showed that straw-based substrate, when supplemented with bran or oil cakes for optimization of the carbon-nitrogen ratio, helped in increasing productivity of mushrooms, for example. And this was done in basically three types of oyster mushrooms, Plutotus florida, P. austriatus, and Sajau kaju, to which they actually supplemented bran, that is wheat and rice, as well as karanj oil cakes and de-oiled soybean flour in basically a paddy straw substrate. So they also showed that usage of these supplements significantly increased yields in terms of fruiting bodies of these three species of Pleurotus. So again, another example is empty fruit bunches, CFB of palm oil industry, solid waste for mushroom cultivation. Oyster mushrooms were grown on paddy straw and empty fruit bunch with different ratios, and it was found that the total yield of mushrooms grown on EFP, that is empty fruit branches, was higher than the yield of the paddy straw. So I think this is a great feedstock, but I think one should exercise a lot of caution while using oils. For example, just giving an example of, let's say, waste cooking oil, which produces something called as malonaldehyde. And that is the risk that this malonaldehyde will accumulate in the biomass. And obviously, malonaldehyde is not good for the health, and it causes a lot of oxidative stress. And needless to say that this might also lead to some regulatory issues in terms of approval for such feedstocks, right? So that was just one thought here. And also in terms of feedstock, it could be biomass feedstocks. Basically, biomass feedstocks are derived from, let's say, cellulosic-based plants or lignocellulosic-based plants. These are either grown specifically for use as biomass raw materials or a secondary to subsequent crop process in which their byproducts or waste are used as biomass. So biomass crops are not considered competition to food crops per se. They utilize a greater amount of plant and therefore providing higher yields. Biomass feedstocks are also more fibrous than other feedstocks, and they require digestion and reconstruction. So you need to process that prior to converting them into chemicals. Obviously, in terms of cost, I think it varies, but usually biomass cost is comparatively cheaper. But again, that involves this clause of you know, basically digesting them or deconstructing them. So that could involve a certain amount of cost here. Again, GMO implications could be mixed here. Yeah, that is an example. For example, agricultural waste, trees, grasses from sorghum. But let's move forward. So in terms of, Yeah, so in terms of traditional fermentation, I think I put these two couple of examples here is just to tell you people that, you know, that is this example of using this fungus rhizopus to ferment soya beans into tempeh and various lactic acid bacteria to produce cheese and yogurt, right? So just think about India and think about the kind of varieties of soy you have in India. That is like 113 varieties of soy. And if you think of adding and the graining, for example, or another couple of grains, and then the permutations and combinations can basically run to millions, right? So it basically allows us this flexibility or allows us to utilize this huge diversity of, let's say, plants which exist in India, and also help us create this diversity of products or new product development as well in terms of, let's say, cheese and milk analogs. Another example is just this Miyoko, which generates cheese from a nut cream fermentation. When we say nut cream, it could be peanut butter, hazelnut paste, almond butter, or let's say almond paste or a pure cashew cream as well. And again, we can think about the varieties and the combinations which are native to India here as well, which are available widely, or also think about in a different way as to what kind of exotic, let's say, formulations of nut cream which you could use to fermentation. So this was basically about traditional fermentation, which I'm speaking about here. Yeah, so these are some of the examples in terms of the actual companies which exist in traditional fermentation, which are innovating in terms of, let's say, feedstock and in terms of the microorganisms which is being used here. For example, US company Prime Roots is using koji filamentous fungi, which is traditionally used in Japan to produce sake, miso, and soy sauce to make it meat-free, to make its basically meat-free range of bacon sausages and as well as chicken varieties of meat. So the company describes koji as a whole food fungus that releases certain proteins and carbohydrates during the fermentation process and creating the umami flavor notes that it makes it ideal for meat alternatives. Similar to that, we have a company called as Chunk, which is based out of Israel, which ferments plant proteins such as soy using cultures to produce whole cut pieces of meat such as steak. So this company basically spun out of MIT, and their first target is beef, and they're also looking forward to moving to fish, seafood, as well as poultry. The other example is the Mediterranean Food Lab. The company uses familiar ingredients such as grains, legumes, vegetables that it ferments in three different ways. Traditional multi-phase as well as solid state, resulting in this meaty, umami-rich, and clean-labeled flavor. And aromatic compounds that plant-based plants can use to improve the taste of their products, basically. So I think Arman just asked about microtechnology, and here's that example here. So one of microtechnology's product is Pure Taste, which uses shiitake mushroom fermentation of a pea and rice protein feedstock to improve the flavor, aroma, and the functional properties of the feedstock. So this approach illustrates one of the first applications of probably the most powerful role of fungi in food, right? So as bioconverters of foodstuff into, say, flavorful, nutritious, as well as functional forms to address certain key challenges in the sector. So specifically, the pea and rice protein feedstock fermented with Pure Taste, according to the company, exhibits reduced undesirable odor and enhanced flavor, greater water and oil binding capacity. And apparently also improved capacity for texturization related to unfermented raw materials. So just to let you know that the Plantera, one of the subsidiaries of the world's largest meat company called JBS, uses pure taste to produce their new Ozo brand line of plant-based meat. So this is some of the applications of how when you produce, let's say, a certain ingredient or when you produce, let's say, a set of ingredients which can plug into, let's say, bigger companies or, you know, very large corporates, then I think you have a winner here. So this is also in terms of innovator showcase, but this is more towards academia. Academia or academic institutions, funding agencies are also getting interested. So there is this new research project, which is called as ProFerment, run by the Department of Food Science, University of Copenhagen, which has received DKK 56 million, approximately 63 crores INR from the Novo Nordisk Foundation to develop the fundamental knowledge required to invent completely new category of, let's say, sustainable plant-based foods as an alternative to animal proteins. So they basically use solid-state fermentation for protein transformations and improve the palatability of plant-based foods. They use basically bacillus in combination of, let's say, different molds, which come into picture as tools to increase digestibility and the content of essential amino acids through fermenting yellow pea as well as oats. So they're also working on rapeseed proteins, which also has huge untapped potential in terms of the quantity of rapeseed proteins produced in northern Europe. And just one more example here is okara, which is a major agro waste generated as a byproduct from the soy milk and tofu industry. Since okara has high nutritive value, reusing it as a substrate for solid state biofermentation is an economical as well as probably an environmental friendly option here. So Rhizopus oligosporus and Lactobacillus plantarum were the probiotic FDA approved food grade cultures used in the study by Gupta et al. The study basically revealed that biofermenting okara improves its natural composition. And this was basically confirmed by GCMS analysis. And they also found that the antioxidant properties were also very higher in these set of experiments. So it also gives you this angle of health along with nutrition. So you can experiment in those lines as well. So in terms of biomass fermentation, the take home message here is, biomass fermentation has the potential to become the most efficient among all these three, as it can basically use much wide range of nutrients and feedstock. So in fact, many complex and inexpensive feedstocks such as agricultural and industrial waste products can be valorized given the ability of many microorganisms, especially filamentous fungi, to metabolize substrates. As such, biomass fermentation not only helps with meeting increasing demand for protein-rich food, but also benefits the environment by recycling waste. So in terms of nutrition and health, I think it generates food products with lower cholesterol, fat, sugar level, as well as probably higher fiber content. And some of the raw materials mainly used are starchy substrates, such as rice, barley, which are derived from basically rice, barley, oats, cassava, wheat bran, cassava meal, corn meal, okara, like I said before, is sweet potato residues as well as banana peel. We have substrates with protein as well. The food and agro industry byproducts such as oil cakes, there are a ton of different types of oil cakes, pumpkin oil cake, soya bean, sesame, groundnut, safflower oil cake, cottonseed oil cake, mustard oil cake for the production of variety of enzymes. Biomass as well as a wide spectrum of secondary metabolites. Next, we have substrates with soluble sugars, molasses, grape pumice, apple pumice, kiwi pumice, lemon peel, lemon pulp, peach pumice, and we have a tons of, you know, even sugar beet pulp, which could be used as substrates for biomass fermentation. We also have cellulose as well as lignocellulosic substrates. Like I said before, most agricultural residues contain high levels of cellulose and lignocellulose, which have the potential to be used as solid substrates. For example, we have sugarcane, bagasse, we have soybean hulls, wheat bran, rice hulls, corn cob, barley husk, barley straw, wheat straw, etc. So in this case, cellulosidic fungi such as Trichoderma, Aspergillus niger, we have Rhizopus species as well as Streptomyces species, which can degrade complex cellulose as well as the lignocellulose to produce simple sugars. And next, again, moving to substrate with soluble sugars, we have molasses, sorry, I think I'm done with this, right? So yeah, I mean, these are some of the substrates which could be really used for in terms of biomass fermentation. So yeah, moving into defined media or inert carrier here, there are various inert carriers which can be used to simulate the conditions of, let's say, solid state fermentation, for example, and these include vermiculite, perlite, clay granules, pozzolano particles, hemp, amberlite, PUVF, that is polyurethane foam and polystyrene. So basically what is done here is the inert carrier is filled with chemically defined media, chemically defined liquid media, and the advantage of solid state fermentation on insert support in comparison to solid state formation on natural solid substrate is you can actually control the definition of this media, right? So some of the natural solid substrates, such as, like I said before, sugarcane, bagasse, or rice cells can be used as inert carrier due to their low nutrients but high porosity and ability to provide a very good support in terms of controlling mass and heat transfer. So yeah, and these are some of the advantages of defined media. So in terms of you can actually precisely modify the production of liquid media. You can control what goes into this liquid media, process modeling, as well as you have control over the whole process. You have good control over how much of water activity you really want to have. The biomass can be actually measured directly. I mean, you can also use, for example, this media to grow several microorganisms, co-culture them as well, if you want to, higher evaporation rates, and that thus you have better control over temperature, as well as you will also have improved control over heat and mass transfer as well. So these are some of the advantages specifically in terms of biomass fermentation, and I've just put some of the advantages in terms of precision fermentation as well. Specifically in terms of precision fermentation, you'll have probably easier product recovery, as well as you'll be able to extract extracellular products or intracellular products with probably fewer impurities because of the way you can actually control the composition of this media. And I've just put this example, corn, which everybody knows, was founded in 1985, and it was the first used biomass fermentation to make ground meats. Corn uses a specific filamentous fungi called as Fusarium veninatum to produce a protein-rich product. And we have an innovator snapshot here of 3F Bio, which is a company based out of Scotland. So it provides an example of innovation in feedstock use and industrial bioprocess. So this company basically uses the same filamentous fungi, which was used by corn and is being used by corn for decades now. But their approach is really innovative in terms of, for example, improving both sustainability and cost by co-locating their production facilities with bioethanol production plants, for example. So the feedstock is here, this basically residual biomass, bioethanol fermentation of grains such as corn and wheat. And right now we have a vast majority of these leftovers, which are sold to, let's say, for example, animal feed industry as low cost source of proteins and calories. And 3F Bio's fungal strains through strain optimization, and they claim to convert this low quality into a much higher quality, let's say, end product in terms of fermented, let's say, or fermentation derived meat products. So this is another example for biomass fermentation. In Israel, we have a company called as Kinoko, which uses mycelium of an edible mushroom as a protein source. So they are growing mushrooms on legumes and beans. And with the mycelium, they are working on developing all kinds of meat products. So this kind of innovation where they have optimized the growth of these mushrooms on specific feedstocks, or the combination of mushroom with legumes and beans, Kinoko claims that they have increased nutritional quality of their product, where they have moved from, let's say, conventional lentils, which has 23% proteins and 73% carbs, to their product, which has higher amount of proteins, that is 35% of proteins and just 58% of carbs. So now that I've covered traditional fermentation as well as biomass fermentation, moving into precision fermentation. So precision fermentation is a great way to advance plant-based products, or precision fermentation itself can stand out in terms of producing high value ingredients, which could plug into hybrid products. And also it can produce ingredients such as growth factors, like I said before, which can plug into cultivated meat. So the ingredients which we are looking could be proteins, enzymes, can also be flavoring agents, vitamins, pigments, which will give the natural color, fat, or other additives that will improve the cooking experience or the nutritional profiles of your end product. So recombinant protein production, these are some of the examples here. Soy like hemoglobin, which I spoke about before, Impossible Foods is actually producing this. This is also through precision fermentation. We have Perfect Day, which is producing milk proteins through precision fermentation. Another player is Clara Foods, which is focused on producing egg proteins, which is also an ingredient which goes into, let's say, bakeries and other areas which use actually egg proteins to make or bake their products, for example. We have companies focused on growth factors. We have companies which are focused on scaffolds, and all these materials can be derived through recombinant protein production platforms. So in terms of scaffolds, proteins such as collagen, proteins such as collagen, fibronectin, etc. could be produced for fermentation, which could directly plug into production of scaffolds for cultivated meat products. So in terms of precision fermentation, moving into media optimization strategies. So media optimization studies are usually carried out till date in, let's say, chemical, food, as well as the pharmaceutical industries, with respect to, let's say, increasing the yield or activity of the desired product. Currently, there is very little knowledge available about the role of factors, the levels in controlling, let's say, the metabolite. Or let's say in terms of alternative proteins, controlling the level of expression of certain proteins, production by different, let's say, strains. And in order to enhance the productivity of metabolites, researchers investigated the nutritional requirements for production of secondary metabolites here in terms of, let's say, pharma, and found that nutritional requirements were varying from strain to strain. So obviously, there was a huge requirement in terms of, let's say, for media optimization strategies here. So the quality and quantity of nutrients available and the ability to, let's say, assimilate successfully are probably some of the major determinants of microbial nature and its metabolic activity. Hence, during a media optimization, it must be considered that minimal growth media requirement of microorganism must be fulfilled for obtaining, let's say, maximum production of your target protein. As the fermentation process progresses into, let's say, a lower value, higher volume system, such as, for example, it might not happen in precision fermentation, but probably in terms of biomass, it becomes necessary to maximize the efficiency as well as the yield, right? So, and also minimize the production cost and mitigate production of a lot of, let's say, waste byproducts. So there are several strategies which have been used so far in terms of media optimization. Some of them are here. One is, let's say, classical medium optimization methods, which uses several different varieties of classical optimizations, such as, let's say, one factor at a time method or FAT. We have removal experiments, we have supplementation experiments, replacement experiments, physical parameters. So in terms of one factor at a time or FAT, this is one of the most classical media optimization methods. Only one factor or one variable is actually varied at a time, while keeping all of the different variables constant. And the concentration of the selected medium or components would then be changed, let's say, over a desired range. So OFAT is pretty easy and convenient, obviously, because you have to change just one factor at a time. And the most preferred choice among researchers for designing the medium composition and used in initial stages of their let's say, project or whatever. So the next one is removal experiments. So in removal experiments, as the name says, all medium components are removed from the production medium one by one. And after the proper, let's say, incubation period or set of time, that affects on the production of secondary metabolite, or let's say the target protein here of interest, is observed in terms of suitable parameters. So the next one is supplementation experiments. In supplementation experiments, what people do is they evaluate the effects of various carbon and nitrogen supplements on the production of your target protein. And replacement would be replacing, right? For example, for media formulation, carbon or nitrogen sources, which shows enhancement effect on the desired protein in supplementation experiments, are generally tried to be used as a whole carbon and nitrogen source. You're basically replacing one source with another source. So in terms of physical parameters, we have all these kinds of different ways of looking into or different experiments in terms of media optimization. These are all classical methods. And let's talk about a little bit about, let's say, physical parameters as well. So obviously physical parameters include pH, would include temperature, agitation, aeration requirements for fermentation process. And for example, even if you consider OFAC method, it has its own advantages as well as disadvantages. I mean, the major advantage with OFAT is its simplicity, like I said before. The major drawback is difficulty in estimating the interactions from, let's say, experiments as it is, let's say, or for example, if you have a hit and miss scatter shot sequence of experiments, probably OFAT is not the method you want to follow. The next one is design of experiments. So design of experiments, or DOE, is used for media optimization in fermentation process. And this is used to overcome the limitations of classical OFAT method and can be a very powerful tool in terms of optimization of metabolite production. So Fisher is the person who proposed this basic theory of experimental design, which shows that changing more than one component in a medium at a time can be more efficient over one factor at a time, which is OFAT. So DOE is a series of experiments which are basically planned and executed to obtain a larger amount of information about the effect of multiple parameters at a time on the output. So most DOE procedures allow the preliminary screening of at least 2 to 10 medium factors. When I say medium, it's basically the medium in which the microbes are growing, medium factors in a limited number of experiments. So in this method, several factors or components are compared simultaneously and the effects are observed and ranked based on the results. So the next one is statistical methods. It's getting a little more complicated here. So basically, obviously microbial processes are very biological in nature and have a large number of natural variations. The network associated with microbial reactions are also very complex, and several factors affect different parts in these types of networks or pathways, right? So rational experimental design and statistical evaluation of results is inevitable, and obviously it increases the knowledge about the reliability of information obtained during these set of experiments. Sorry, the next. So hence, the experiments must be planned really well, properly, strategically planned with sufficient amount of sample size to obtain adequate data, which is essential to basically answer your objective. For example, what you're asking in this experiment, is your media good enough to, let's say, grow XYZ type of microorganism? Is it good to grow, let's say, co-culture of microbes, which you're looking for? What is it that you're looking for, and probably should plan it really strategically in order to move forward. So in a full, for example, in a full factorial design, all combinations of factors, that is pH, strain, medium components, temperature, everything is tested. And on the other hand, partial factorial analysis is done when you don't have an option to do full factorial design, and probably you have some or little knowledge about the interactions of the medium here. So, this is pretty complex, so I'm not going into it, because I myself do not understand the complexities of nitty-gritties of what is inside here, but we have like tons of designs. We have examples of bracket Bowman design, central composite design, Taguchi design, box Penkin design. So bracket Bowman design is a two-level design, which is very useful for economically detecting the main effect and assuming that all other interactions are negligible and comparing this the sum important major effects. That is where there is no interaction, the observed effect of a factor can be superior or underestimated by the other factors. So I'll not just get into the other ones because I think it requires a much more deeper understanding of it. But this is just to highlight that these are some of the options for people who are interested in fermentation to optimize their media. So we have optimization techniques as well. We have response surface methodology, artificial neural network, genetic algorithm, NELDermeat, a simplex. For example, in response surface methodology, development of, when we actually develop pharmaceutical formulations, various production mediums and process variables would be involved. For example, in terms of productivity, safety, usefulness, and all these needs to be optimized. So probably the relationship or the true relationship between, let's say, media parameters and productivity is quite difficult to understand, and it creates problems in terms of optimizing. For pharmaceutical industries, it's formulation, but for alternative protein industries, it is your end product, basically. So this has basically been applied, for example, has been applied to optimize the formulation variables and optimization of fermentation process. A couple of examples here, a couple of researchers used RSM for, let's say, validation of their production, protein production, for example, creatinase production from a specific. Sorry, I lost the connection to my headphone, but it's now back. Basically, when they applied this specific response surface methodology model to their experimental design, they got to know that their creatinase production, for example, increased like 1.4-fold. And another scientist called us, he reported that that was an increased production of, let's say, Y-glutamic acid by 3.7-folds from its target organism, that is Bacillus lignoformis, by optimizing nutrient concentration using RSM.
Actually, I'm sorry to disrupt, but there's some kind of noises now that you're talking.
Okay.
Something with your microphone.
Yeah, just let me reconnect. Sorry, is it okay now, Michal?
Yes, it sounds good.
Yeah, thanks for pointing that out. Moving forward, we also have artificial neural network, which is a mathematical or computational model that is influenced by, let's say, the structural as well as functional aspects of biological neural networks. In simple words, this is what I understood. They're simply trained using a data set and then applied to predict new data points. So again, when we say data set, prior knowledge or equations is not essential for this training, as the network and systems are actually remain like a black box to the user. Similarly, we have this genetic algorithm as well as NELDermeat simplex, but I'm not going to the details of that for today. Just moving into the problems and bottlenecks of media optimization techniques itself. So most of these techniques use, let's say, shake flask studies. And usually media optimization studies involve large number of experiments, irrespective of the kind of media which is being chosen, which accounts for obviously labor cost and is an open-end experiment basically. So rarely the data generated from, let's say, shake flask media match exactly with fermentation studies. In other words, the data which comes out of shake flask studies, when you do actual fermentation studies, there is a lot of mismatch which happens here. So all shake flask studies suffer from these four weaknesses. That is, the pH cannot be controlled. There is poor oxygen transfer capabilities. Sometimes there is inadequate mixing and considerable evaporation happens during the process. And when we actually try to replicate the data, it is widely assumed that the best medium obtained, let's say in this shake flask culture experiment or method, will be the best media in the fermenter as well, in the bioreactor as well. But unfortunately, there have been not many rigorous studies to compare the medium performances at different scales. And probably this is the time, probably in terms of the scale which we require for alternative proteins, this is the time that we need such rigorous studies to be done. So furthermore, the industrial scale medium usually suffer from problems which happens as usual in scientific studies, batch to batch variability, availability around the year, fluctuations in price, stability during transport time, cost problems associated with bulk storage and time. And also obviously microbes and cells are very dynamic in nature with a lot of their own internal control mechanisms, but most media optimization studies treat them as black box, like I said before, or utilize solely for empirical data only. So we believe what we believe is that the next generation of medium optimization techniques should take the metabolic pathway regulatory mechanism also into consideration, and probably even the rate of mutations that occur in the particular medium under the influence of let's say media components should also probably be considered, which might influence the yield as well as the product which we are interested in to produce in. So if mutant strains are available, they should be also explored in media optimization studies, which will help us probably develop a new process also. So that's also an avenue which should be left open. And also many of these optimization studies are focused on, let's say, the liquid culture based fermentation. And when we come to solid or semi-solid state fermentation, there is lack of such methods to actually, you know, do this kind of specific optimization for media. And when one of the biggest problems which researchers face is that when should one stop applying optimization techniques, right? For example, the statistical methods of optimization, these neural networks, and nobody knows, so when is the right time to stop putting a plug to these optimizations technique? And designing a fermentation medium can be a never-ending process or a problem, and which is dependent on various factors as we have discussed so far. Okay. So just moving quickly into microalgae and seaweed, I think we are almost at time now. So quickly looking into algae sources of high value products. We had a question from one of the participants today, but we'll be replying soon to that, but shouldn't be a problem there. But yeah, just wanted to point out here is algae are sources of very high value products such as polyunsaturated fatty acids, omega-3 fatty acids, and seaweeds can contain up to 100 times more vitamins and minerals per dry matter. So this I've gone through during our check-in webinars: microalgae, low biomass, high protein content, seaweed has high biomass and low protein content. And, basically some of the bottlenecks here is like what the other areas face, like, you know, for example, fungi faces or whatever, lack of research data, lack of feedstock, high feedstock cost, and insufficient data in terms of how the side stream can be optimized and valorized. So microalgae can be grown in open systems like shallow ponds, circular ponds, raceway ponds. And also the second option is growing them in photobioreactors. This is basically talking about photoautotrophic cultivation here. So high surface area to volume ratio, that is low risk of contamination and control of culture environment, that is efficient gas transfer, control on temperature as well as water loss in terms of photobioreactors. But again, there are downsides of photobioreactor systems as well. In other words, it's expensive, the capex is very high, and in order to make it viable, it needs to be lowered. for commercial production of, let's say, low value compounds like proteins into smart protein or fermentation derived proteins, basically. So in terms of microalgae, heterotrophic cultivation, high productivity of microalgae in heterotrophic systems is usually seen, which is basically a consequence of high energy density of carbon sources in the form of organic carbon and no limitations of varying photo intensity over growth cycle. In addition, we also see that heterotrophic cultivation also benefits from the closed nature of bioreactors, allowing for control of, let's say, nutrient feed rate, oxygen supply, and agitation. Obviously, there are challenges with this as well. The requirement, for example, in heterotrophic cultivation, the requirement of oxygen-enriched air and high feedstock costs due to addition of organic carbs such as, let's say, glucose. Perhaps you have to add glucose, you have to add acetate, you have to add a bunch of other things such as crop flows, wastewater, not wastewater here in terms of food, but waste from probably food industry. These are some of the bottlenecks here. And the cost of feedstock can be optimized by utilizing side streams from industrial food processing units, such as molasses, but still a lot needs to be explored in this area. So that is one more methodology we call as mixotrophic cultivation, which combines autotrophic as well as heterotrophic cultivation. This is but in its incipient, or it's very nascent. This technology is very nascent, but there is a lot of promise in the space in terms of higher growth rates as well as a shorter growth cycle and higher lipid and as well as protein productivity. So this is basically a table which compares photoautotrophic and heterotrophic, not exotrophic. So obviously you can see the main difference here is in terms of, the yield, right? Heterotrophic cultivation gives you very, very high yield. But at the same time, we have the raw material cost, which is also very high here. And also in terms of the potential to explore, I think both are equally opportunistic in terms of, or provide equal opportunity in terms of exploration. But just wanted to point this out. This is also there in our analysis or strategic analysis of algae and seaweed as well. So if people are interested, please go do the strategic analysis and we can have a look at this as well there. So yeah, so in terms of seaweed, people use tumble culture, which utilizes basically tanks or closed environments to cultivate seaweed. The key advantages of tumble culture are the ability to standardize growth conditions such as nutrient, light penetration, water quality, preventing heavy metal buildup and water circulation. So the contamination by, let's say, industrial effluents and sewage discharges can also be avoided, and there's a possibility of, automating this in future. The basic disadvantages, again, it's basically the higher capex for setup of cultivation system inland and regulatory hurdles for seawater use, for example, and what will you do with the spent medium? How will you discharge it? So the key parameters that determine seaweed growth include nutrient quality, penetration of sunlight, temperature, salinity, water circulation, and oxygen and carbon dioxide concentration. And obviously, seaweeds are also very sensitive in terms of climatic changes as well as geographical conditions. So these, for example, if there are any specific seaweed which grows in temperate zones, they cannot basically grow in tropical zones as well. And also, I mean, seaweeds are basically subject to pathogenic microorganisms, such as cyanobacteria, which attach themselves to seaweed surface. So the contamination issue is always there. Hence, whenever you want to do this kind of tumble culture, I think site selection also plays a very, very important role in determining the efficiency of cultivation here. So in terms of the requirement, the general demand for carbon, nitrogen, phosphorus in terms of seaweed is higher demand for carbon, followed by nitrogen and then phosphorus. And again, this is very dynamic in terms of seaweed. Each seaweed species has its own growth characteristics and its new composition. And again, that means there is a correlation in terms of, or a difference in terms of the amount of required carbon, nitrogen, and phosphorus. Excuse me, one minute. Sorry for that. So the macronutrients that seaweeds need to grow are usually relatively abundant in temperate waters. And the nutrient concentration within the cells, for example, within seaweed cells is 100,000 times higher for nitrogen and 10,000 times for phosphorus for carbon compared to their ambient seaweed concentrations. Apologies for that. So the limiting elements for seaweed growth are nitrogen and phosphorus, while sea is usually not that limiting due to profound exchange of water between the water surface as well as atmosphere here. So here is an example of porphyra species, nori or purple labor, which is basically grown using net cultivation. And there are several different species of seaweed which are actually consumed. For example, kombu, aonori, wakame, hiziki, most of these are Japanese breeds of seaweeds, or different like other examples of seaweeds which are grown. Varieties, not weeds, but varieties of seaweed. So moving on to the last slide here, I think we have covered everything. Hopefully, I've been able to cover all areas in terms of feedstock. But generally speaking about the value chain here again, we have host strain engineering, and we have the feedstock stage here. And I think it's very important to consider, in terms of what kind of life cycle analysis happens here, what kind of economic implications are here in terms of, let's say, when you're plugging into, this is an example, just in terms of, let's say, agricultural residues into the feedstock stage. And also in terms of how much of land you'll be using, what is your energy coefficiency in terms of utilization of energy, as well as emission factors in terms of collection of all these agricultural residues, which actually form your feedstock. It could be industrial residues as well. And this is where I think there's a dearth of studies which needs to be done. For example, there was an LCA analysis done by Smetna et al. Of microalgae and cyanobacteria cultivation in both autotrophic as well as heterotrophic conditions on a pilot industrial scale. And they compared it to basically traditional benchmarks such as protein concentrates. This is again there in the strategic analysis. Please go and have a look. And they found that there is higher environmental impact of microalgae, which is much more environmental friendly, sustainable product than pork and beef. And similarly, for example, there was a economic analysis done by the National Renewable Energy Laboratory, where they evaluated the future economic potential of algal biomass production, let's say across photobioreactor designs. And they also quantified by, let's say, the minimum biomass selling price if they actually generate or create this algal biomass using these PBR designs, basically. So I think this was just to highlight that very few or handful of literature exists in terms of LCA and TA analysis. And I think these studies need to be done using several different considerations in order to make the path for, let's say, more research investments and funding flowing into the sector, and especially in terms of seaweed and microalgae. So this was about it in terms of my presentation for today. And I think we can just move into the Q&A now. Mikhail?
Yes, hi. I can't open my camera.
That's okay. No worries. So there are a few questions. Probably I'll push it to you first and see if I can answer them as well. Is that okay?
Yeah, sure.
Yeah. So Swapnil has a question on solid state fermentation. So in solid state fermentation process, specifically mushrooms like Cleopteris, which are considered to closely mimic fish, the spent media is still rich in nutrition. Is there any way we can utilize that?
Theoretically, yes. One of the things that needs to be taken under consideration is that solid state fermentation, one of the challenges is the low homogenicity. So I don't think you can take the let's say you're using a tray bioreactor, taking this solid state and growing, utilizing it again and growing it once more. You need to do some kind of homogenizing step and take means of measuring the nutrients that you have there and see how you can use it.
Yeah, thanks for that answer, Mikhail. Hope that answers your question, Safnil. But he also has one more question. If the nutrient source is a GMO that gives a better feed, say lipids, can be used, or should we not use GMO products altogether?
So GMO is an issue that really depends on where you're going to use this food. If you're using it in United States, you don't really have a problem. In other places, as you know, you have other issues. So if the ingredient that you, I'm not really sure about the regulations of the GMO, but I'm guessing that if you're using a nutrient source that is GMO, but it is all utilized in the process, I don't think that the final product is GMO, but you have to check it again with the regulations in the area that you're interested in producing your product.
Thanks, Mikhail. Just for Swapnil's information, I think just adding to what Mikhail said in terms of GMO, I think you should make sure or try to make sure at least that your end product does not have GMO as much as possible, probably less than 1%. That is what is some of the regulations, which specifically I'm talking about India, where FSSAI is actually contemplating on. So, and also I think you should also think about if your nutrient source is a GMO, what kind of GMOs from, or GMO, let's say nutrients, if there are any GMO nutrients, GM nutrients, how are they assimilated by this microorganism? Would they be broken down? Would there be, any trace of this GM at the end is the ultimate question. I mean, it's not that it should not have GM at the end, but that will be subject to a very different kind of regulation altogether. So that's what I meant. Okay, so the next question is, why does corn still use liquid glucose as a substrate instead of cheaper alternatives like biomass?
So the story of corn is really interesting. So it's the first company, the biomass company, that was established in 1985. And originally she wanted, the company, the inventors wanted to use starch as a feedstock because they were part of another company that, if I remember correctly, a big grain and flour company. So they had a lot of starch by their hands, and they wanted to find microorganisms, specifically a filamentous fungi, that will grow on this starch. Once they found this filamentous fungi that they wanted to work with, and this is another story, they saw that on starch it didn't grow really, really well. So they shifted to glucose. And this is one of the challenges that they're still dealing with. So it's if you go to the story of corn and there are articles about it, you can see the past and current challenges, and one of the challenges is corn, is the glucose that they're using. But it's really important to take into consideration that once you have a production process that is running, that you got the approval, the safety approval on, it's really, really difficult to make changes during the process. Once you make any change, even if in the feedstock or in the strain or in the conditions you grow your microorganism, you need to make sure that the final product is exactly the same as the final product that you gotten the approval, the safety approval on. So I'm not sure that now it really makes sense for them to make this shift. They really need to make this decision. One of the problems or the issues that can occur is the mycotoxins that the filamentous fungi is producing. And if you're growing it on another feedstock, it can make more mycotoxins. So it's a really safety issue. I hope this answers the question.
Well, Mikhail, definitely it will help. Okay, if we can move to the next question, Arman has a question again. Can you talk about soy whey as a potential feedstock?
So the way soy whey is used as a feedstock in other food applications, I'm not sure about fermentation, but your question really takes me to the another point that I want to talk about is or an issue that is important to look at all the milk industry. When we're using plant-based milk, for example, you need to remember that the microorganisms that we're using in the traditional milk industry are not optimized to do the fermentation in the plant-based milk, for example. So you need to make optimizations either in the strains that you are using or in the feedstock. In order for you to use such feedstocks. This is my answer. It's partially relevant to what you asked. But I hope it
helps. Thanks, Mikhail. I mean, if participants do have any add-on questions, and participants, please feel free to raise your hand and I'll unmute you in case you know you have something to add to this. Okay, this is done. So the next question is, there any particular reason why target selection was left at slide 9? Okay, let me check that for you, Sagarika. I'll get back to you on that. Are there any strategies, Aswin is asking, are there any strategies used to get past product feedback inhibition while doing precision fermentation?
Yeah, so when you're using submerged fermentation versus solid state fermentation, in precision fermentation, you can grow your microorganisms in different modes of growing them. You can use batch, fed batch, and continuous. You can read about it, but in general, when you're talking about continuous fermentation, one of the things that you're doing is adding, in one hand, you're adding new feedstocks or media to the fermenter, but in the other hand, you're taking out the used media. So when you're doing that, you're also removing all kind of byproducts that could be toxic or even your product that could be toxic. So this is one way that you can remove from your process undesirable products, but you need to think that we're talking about products that are expressed extracellular. If you have, if your product, for example, is toxic and it's only expressed intracellular, so you have a problem. But if it's extracellular and you're using submerged fermentation, you can definitely take out the used media with the toxic product and add new media and continue the process theoretically forever. It's not always this case, because there's other issues, but you can really grow your microorganism for a longer period of time.
Thank you for that, Mikhail. But there is one last question here. But before that, if that are any participants who want to answer or ask a question live, please raise your hand and I can go ahead and unmute you. Let's wait for a few seconds. Okay, one last question from Swapnil. Please share insights on market of seaweed in India. I mean, we have very limited insights on the market of seaweed in India, Swapnil, but I think if you can come up with, let's say, innovative products, or if that would be a report on, let's say, market of seaweed, probably we'll be looking into it very soon, but we don't have insights. But obviously, the market of seaweed elsewhere is really good. But I don't have a clear answer for that right now. But let me see who else is there here. So it's only Nicole, me, and Mikhail. But if you want, Mikhail can talk towards insights of market of seaweed elsewhere. If you're comfortable doing that, Mikhail.
I'm not sure that seaweed is my specialty. Specialties, yeah. And also in Israel, there are not many, many companies are growing here. So I'm not sure I have much of the insights on that.
Okay, sorry, Swapnil, we couldn't answer that question for you, but I hope the rest of the attendees could gain some insights out of this session and some of the answers were useful for you guys. So thank you very much, everyone. Thank you, Mikhail, for jumping in to attend the Q&A session and answering some of these questions. And thank you all attendees for your time. And this was the last webinar for phase two, and we'll soon be moving to phase three. And all the best to all participants in terms of the proposals for both track one and track two. Have a good evening and have a good weekend, everyone. Take care.
Bye. Thank you.